Captain Midnight.
I want to begin this video by talking about two shows with great first seasons. Netflix's Russian Doll and HBO's Succession. Both shows were favorably reviewed and generally well-liked upon release, and nominated for Emmys. But I think it's safe to say that Russian Doll was seen as a much bigger deal at the time of release. It's hard to compare these things since Netflix's numbers are fairly secretive and kind of all over the place, but just going by the Google trends, it's easy to see that people talked about that first season a lot. It really dwarfs the searches for Succession Season 1 about half a year earlier. But then, something funny happened. Something that I think is really indicative of a lot of Netflix's programming problems. Succession grew, season after season. Word of mouth spread, weekly discussions as the show aired got livelier, and more people were watching every year. Slowly but surely, it kinda became the crown jewel of the current HBO lineup. Russian Doll, on the other hand, just released its second season, also well reviewed, to, I don't want to say silence, but clearly far less buzz than season one. This is not me slamming Russian Doll, I'm a fan. But I think it points to a far larger problem than just one show. Netflix series just aren't built to grow. Most of the time, the first season releases either catch a lot of attention and dominate the discourse for a week or two, or just pass by without much fanfare. With season two, it becomes even harder, with many shows failing to recapture that popularity that they briefly had. Is it any wonder most of their shows barely make it past a third season? Their dump everything at once model was a fun novelty back in 2015, but to me, it's clear that in the long run, they're really shooting themselves in the foot. Where shows like Succession, The Mandalorian, and Euphoria can hold on to an audience and grow fan passion over time, Netflix doomed a lot of its own shows to being flash in the pans, even when they're good enough to deserve better. About a year ago, I made a video with a, I will admit, pretty melodramatic title, The Fall of Netflix, in which I predicted that the loss of shows like Friends and The Office was going to be a big problem for the platform. These are beloved, constantly rewatched hits with hundreds of episodes, the exact kind of show that Netflix has failed to replicate in any meaningful way with its own model. Couple that with rising competition, who, in a couple cases, have far deeper libraries, and I didn't think things looked too great for them. I took a lot of flack for that video in the comments section, but honestly, with all the news that's come out recently, I do think it's aged pretty well. Netflix is in trouble. They were the undisputed king of streaming for most of the last decade, and now they're losing subscribers to both Disney Plus and HBO Max, with those constant price hikes not really helping. In an absurd economic system that demands infinite growth forever, that's a major issue. So Netflix's stock has dropped hard, like really hard. I think you could point to a lot of different factors for why they've had a rough go of it lately, with some not even being their fault. As all these other companies started their own streaming services, it was inevitable that popular shows and movies like Friends, The Office, Back to the Future, and Star Trek were all going to be taken off and moved to HBO Max, Peacock, or wherever. To combat this, Netflix has spent billions on new programming. Some of it has even been really good, but not nearly enough has clicked with people. And even when it does, I do think people have become really hesitant to get invested in their shows. A self-contained sketch comedy series like I Think You Should Leave is one thing, but when it comes to serialized dramas especially, Netflix has lost some major trust among viewers. Glow, The OA, American Vandal, Sense8, City of Ghosts, every Marvel show, I could sit here and list canceled Netflix stuff all day. Now, obviously every major platform out there does cancel TV shows. I'm old enough to remember when Fox had the reputation of canning everything, and Netflix was the knight in shining armor ready to ride in and save the day. But I think what makes Netflix's current model feel worse to people is that even when their shows are successful, they generally don't last very long. Better Call Saul, a show produced by Sony, just started its sixth and final season on AMC here in America and on Netflix in much of the rest of the world. Does anyone seriously think this series would have made it that far if it was an actual Netflix original? Only a few shows from those first few years of originals, like BoJack Horseman, Grace and Frankie, and Orange is the New Black, really got that many seasons. Now it just seems like shows are lucky to get four very short ones. And that works really well for some shows, but it also cuts down on how much those series can really do. You couldn't get the blend of serialization and standalone episodes that shows like The Good Wife, Angel, and Brooklyn Nine-Nine have with Netflix originals. And even shows with mostly only 10 to 13 episodes per season, like The Sopranos, Ray Donovan, or The Wire, would still be too long for how the streamer usually operates. As someone who really likes shows that build out expansive worlds with lots of different avenues of stories and characters to explore, that's disappointing, and it makes a lot of Netflix shows feel far more like bloated movies than TV shows that are using their medium to its fullest potential. I mentioned BoJack Horseman earlier, which is one of the big crowning achievements of Netflix originals, but that success in animation seems to have really sputtered out. While most sites were busy reporting on Netflix's stock and their announcement that they're going to start cracking down on password sharing, The Wrap put out an article about how much Netflix animation has changed in the past few years. It's a great piece, and I'm really going to try to remember to link it down in the description. One anonymous animation producer described how when they first arrived, Netflix said they, quote, wanted to be the home of everyone's favorite show. But over time, that thesis changed to, quote, we want to make what the audience wants to see. This apparently led them to touting the Boss Baby series as their benchmark of success, using it as an example for the type of numbers that other animated shows need to hit. That's interesting to me because it brings up the very simple question, why would the Boss Baby show be doing so much better than most of their animation? My guess is it has less to do with the quality of the show and more the fact that it's riding the coattails of a movie franchise with a massive marketing budget. For better or worse, everyone has heard of this baby who wears a suit, whereas most Netflix series, especially animated shows, get barely any marketing at all. According to The Wrap, quote, promotion doesn't typically begin until a month before the show's premiere. Sometimes they haven't even been announced before then. This leaves a very small window to build awareness and anticipation, much less cultivate genuine excitement. And once the show debuts on the platform, it can often get lost in the shuffle, leading many creators to become their own hype machines via various social media platforms. Levers that other animation studios at bigger corporations can pull, like consumer product releases or promotional tie-ins, are not pulled at Netflix. There weren't Kid Cosmic action figures lining the shelves of Target. You couldn't get a City of Ghosts Happy Meal toy at McDonald's. On the official Netflix shop, there isn't a single kids and family animated series represented. I know that was a really long quote, but I wanted to get through it because I think it cuts to the heart of so many of Netflix's problems. When a show will usually come out through Cartoon Network or HBO Max and get a decent amount of promotion, Netflix is spending money producing things it just leaves out to dry. Is it any wonder that showrunners, especially on the animation side, are leaving in droves? Some of the problems Netflix is facing were inevitable when going up against titans like Warner Brothers. But many of them feel like the direct result of Netflix just straight up fumbling their opportunities. Their strategy of shotgun blasting as many TV shows and movies onto the platform as they can with very little promotion just feels like a failing one, not to mention incredibly expensive. For every hit like Stranger Things, a show that costs $30 million an episode by the way, there's 15 hoops. One season long shows that are forgotten 2 weeks after they launch. And the sad thing is, some of those shows, unlike Hoops, are actually good and deserve some real attention but had no marketing put behind them. With all these recent price hikes, something had to give. So Netflix announced on an earnings call that it would be introducing a subscription tier with ads at a lower price point. I don't know how successful this will be, but honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if it was kind of a tough sell. Unlike Hulu, which has integrated ads from the start, Netflix users haven't had to put up with them for over 10 years. That was one of the biggest appeals of Netflix when it launched. I know it definitely appealed to me, you know, just fire up the Wii and watch Firefly, you don't have to worry about ads. In 2011, Netflix Instant really represented a break from the norm, an ad-free space where shows weren't shackled by the time constraints of time slots and commercials. I'll admit, it was a really attractive vision of the future, but one that, with the benefit of hindsight, I think it's worth asking how great it actually was. I mean, all it takes is watching an Arrested Development episode that aired on Fox versus one that was released on Netflix to see that maybe being forced to cut things and have really disciplined editing actually helps shows more than it hinders them in a lot of cases. Recent years, which have seen more and more Netflix dramas bloat to hour-long plus episodes, have only given me more appreciation for the tight, exciting runtimes of, say, Breaking Bad Season 3, which always came in under 50 minutes. Not to mention, a lot of the creative freedom that came from leaving the networks and cable seems to have evaporated due to Netflix's constant use of their algorithm to steer programming. Showrunners like Maniac's Cary Fukunaga have even admitted as much, saying that Netflix never wants to lose, quote, binging momentum, and that the algorithm's argument is gonna win at the end of the day. So whatever creative constraints have been imposed by car commercials and insurance ads have just been replaced by far more machine-driven ones over at Netflix. TV is not, and has never been, perfect. There's always been some really good stuff on, and a lot of junk. But at least in the past, especially on cable, good shows felt like they had a real chance to succeed. A show like The Shield was a real shot in the dark for FX back in 2002, but they promoted the hell out of it, people liked it, and it went on to 7 great seasons, with the best one being its final. That's a real TV success story, and one that very, very few Netflix shows even have a shot at. Between their dump everything all at once model and their lack of promotion, they're killing a lot of shows. I think it's probably time for Netflix to act a little less like a tech company that's riding high off of an unlimited supply of investor money, and more like a real studio that does everything it can to set up its productions for success. Shows like Succession and Yellowstone, as different as they are from each other, show that there's still a lot of value in really getting behind a series for the long haul, as they've only grown in popularity. If Netflix continues to run through their shows and films like they're just interchangeable slop, barely promoted and mildly important the week of launch and then completely disposable, why should viewers treat their programming any differently? Russian Doll and Succession are both great shows, but one is being shepherded by HBO, not Netflix, and as the years pass, I'm starting to think that's what makes all the difference.
Here's a special tip for the fellas and girls who have not already joined Captain Midnight's new 1940 Flight Patrol. You'd better hurry up and join at once, because there's a big adventure ahead. The thing to do now is to get started, because we're going to have not only barrels of fun, but loads of free gifts and prizes too.